How excited out of 10 would you be to devise a synthesis of the impressive tetracyclic natural product Gibberelin A18 methyl ester? If you're not at a 100 out of 10 like the rest of us, no worries. Not only is the job already done for you, allowing you to just lay back and relax, but we also have some intriguing science to cover, as this is not your ordinary middle-of-the-pack natural product. Gibberelins play a critical role for plants and mankind. They are the reason why we avoided a global hunger wave in the 20th century. In addition, gibberelins are also connected to exotic things like genetically modified elite rice and could open up new mechanisms of action against cancer. So this will be a great video for you, even if you only have a basic understanding of chemistry and want to hear just more about science in general. We will cover four main topics today. Firstly, why the gibberelins are literally vital for plant growth and agriculture. Secondly, how today's molecule GA18 was first isolated. Obviously, in extremely painful natural product chemist style. How would you like isolating just 14 milligrams of product starting from 44 tons of bamboo shoots? Thirdly, how its recent first synthesis was planned, including very clever synthetic disconnections. And lastly, how the lab synthesis played out, where we will deep dive into the specific steps and also give you the opportunity to put your chemistry understanding to the test. Gibberelins were first discovered in the rice pathogen fungi Gibberella, but are produced by plants themselves as well and constitute a major class of signaling molecules. You see, before the photosynthetic apparatus develops in the early stages of seed germination, the stored energy reserves of starch nourish the seedling. Gibberelins in the seed embryo are believed to signal starch hydrolysis by inducing the synthesis of the enzyme alpha amylase, giving the seed its much needed energy. There are many more functions which we will not cover because plants were always quite boring to me. Sorry, plant biologists. What's interesting though is how gibberelins are manipulated in modern agriculture. In the 1960s, the introduction of semi-dwarf rice led to record yield increases throughout Asia and other emerging countries, playing a critical role in the world's ability to feed mankind. These semi-dwarf varieties are much more resistant to environmental factors and provide higher yields. It might be surprising that smaller plants have higher yields, but the dwarfed stature allows the plants to allocate disproportionately more resources to the grain rather than to vegetative tissues. Beyond giving the world enough food to live on, the so-called Green Revolution also avoided creation of additional farmland and is estimated to have lowered child mortality in developing countries by almost 5 percentage points. There are also contrary arguments being made against monocropping and use of agrochemicals that came with it, so the matter is quite complex. Over the last 5 decades, multiple biotechnological approaches emerged to introduce dwarfism. For example, key anabolic enzymes such as the GA3 oxidase can be silenced to reduce gibberelin concentrations. Or instead, as shown in this example, expression of catabolic enzymes like GA2 oxidase can be increased, breaking down the active growth promoter gibberelins and leading to the dwarf phenotypes. There obviously is ongoing research into the further optimization of crops, such as this very interesting publication which used CRISPR gene editing to generate semi-dwarf lines in so-called elite Chinese land races. Compared to non-elite rice, which has a very narrow genetic pool, the elite rice have robust agronomic traits such as tolerance to low phosphorus and broad-spectrum resistance to diseases and insects. You can see highlighted in pink that the SD variants of the elite Casalaf rice variety they created were indeed smaller and thus more resistant, as well as improved yields as well. Lastly, if you've seen more than just 2 natural products in your entire life, you will know that everything under the blue moon has some form of anti-cancer activity. For example, just 2 years ago, medicinal chemists identified gibberelin derivatives that are potent inhibitors of NF-kappa-B. In classical style, they tested various gibberelin analogs and found that many of them induced cytotoxicity in breast cancer, lung cancer, and other cell lines, proceeding actually via a new mechanism of action. This shows there is broad medicinal interest in gibberelin natural products and derived lead compounds have promise for future therapeutic innovation. So what about gibberellin A18 methyl ester, the specific molecule at hand? It was first isolated in 1968 by researchers at Kyoto University. If you've watched some of my old videos, you know what's coming up. As is bread and butter for natural product chemists, they had to painstakingly perform large-scale extractions of 162 kilograms of plant seeds, followed by various chromatography steps. Their finally isolated crystalline gibberellin product corresponded to just 0.00058% yield. An even more unbelievable related isolation is the one of gibberellin A19, which was isolated 2 years earlier in quantities of 14 milligrams, starting from 44 tons of bamboo shoots. Things like this get me every time. The biosynthesis of gibberellins goes through the terpenoid pathway, starting with N-chorine, which is synthesized from the basic building block GGDP. The biosynthesis proceeds via selective stepwise oxidation, allowing a 6-5 contraction to transform the trans-decalin into a trans-hydrindane framework. From this precursor called GA12, there are various additional oxidations and functionalizations that deliver the diverse family of gibberellins, as exemplified by these bunch of pathways. This family spans many molecules, and some of them have enjoyed a lot of attention from synthetic chemists in the past. E.J. Corey's 1978 synthesis of gibberellic acid is a really cool one, as it employs a simple but powerful intramolecular Diels Alder reaction to complete the ring system and conveniently leaves a double bond for functionalization in the last steps. Most synthetic efforts happened at the end of the 20th century and the field remained quite dormant since. It makes sense as nowadays some gibberellins can be produced on a ton scale via fermentation for commercial use. However, elucidation of specific gibberellins like A18 or the NF-kappa-B inhibitors would still benefit from more facile synthetic access. This is why a team of chemists at Emory University developed the first total synthesis of the yet unaccessed GA18 methyl ester. As usual, we will start with a brief retrosynthetic analysis first and then turn to its implementation in the forward sense. The target molecule has three all-carbon quaternary centers and a bunch of oxidized carbons which all need to be installed in a clever manner. The right-hand side bridge brings a lot of complexity, so it's sensible to start from there. Now, instead of spoiling you already with quite a nice reaction sequence, we will just assume that this is done through some obscure magic trick. A question to you, what synthetic steps might achieve this transformation starting from the unsaturated ketone shown here? Feel free to pause the video for a minute or two to reflect. We will get back to this shortly. Obviously, there's also some protection and oxidation games going on, but you should focus on the structural changes instead. This unsaturated ketone screams aldol reaction at you, and in this case, the commonly applied ozonolysis aldol sequence would nicely install the side chain as well as create the 6-5-6 ring system. The intermediate, assuming we would get it by simple oxidation of an alcohol, is a keying element for an intramolecular alderene reaction which would create the third 6-membered ring. The cool thing about this route is that it allows us to enter the synthesis from the very available andrographolide, which has the rest of the structure more or less set up already. This synthesis is guided by the starting material, which nicely leverages the existing structure. And that's why we deconstructed the bridged right-hand side of GA18 first. One of the key requirements of modern total synthesis is efficiency, scalability, and the number of steps. It has been clear since the days of Cori that such molecules can be created with brute force if enough chemists work long enough on it. Particularly for terpenes, strategic use of accessible starting materials is common nowadays and has been exemplified in many modern syntheses, such as ones from Phil Barron. Let's now look at the specifics of the actual synthesis. The andrographolide starting material has the benefit of coming with conveniently placed hydroxyl groups. However, these require protection throughout the synthesis. That's why, in a stepwise manner, the alcohols were protected. So first the most reactive one at C19 and subsequently the secondary ones at C3 and C14. The protection conditions also created the eliminated conjugated product at C14, which didn't matter too much. That's because the trisubstituted double bond was oxidatively cleaved with potassium permanganate, actually in presence of the exomethylene group. This cleavage generated an aldehyde, which was expanded by one carbon through vitic olefination and hydrolysis of the resulting enol ether under acidic conditions. Very conveniently, the free aldehyde engaged in the alderene cyclization in the same pot. Another question for you. Can you write down the mechanism of this reaction? Many of you will know that the ene rearrangement is usually a concerted reaction and can involve different types of systems. In this case, the aldehyde is the enophile, with its LUMO engaging the HOMO of the allylic hydrogen system. This forms a six-membered ring. It's also diastereoselective, but this did not really matter as the next steps entailed oxidation of that chiral center with PCC to the ketone anyways. Then, the stage was set for the reductive ozonolysis and aldol sequence. To trigger condensation of the ketoaldehyde intermediate, they simply threw in some acid in the same pot and got the product in low but acceptable yield. This is a nice example of what you might know from your personal emotional life already. Sometimes you have to break down to build back stronger. Now we are at the magic trick step, and I hope you had some time to think about your preferred reactions. The unsaturated ketone obviously lends itself to many different approaches, and I'm sure the team tried many. But one of them is the powerful 2 plus 2 photo addition commonly used to create quaternary carbons. The reaction partner alene is a gas that in this case was prepared via elimination of dichloropropene with magnesium. Cooling things down to frosty minus 100 degrees Celsius, they saw high diastereoselectivity, probably because the bottom face of the molecule is directly shielded by the substituents at the two existing quaternary carbons. Next, they also reduced the aldehyde. Here another, this time easier question for you. Why did the hydride not reduce the ketone too? Now you might say the 2 plus 2 was nice to create the last quaternary carbon, but what do we do with this four-membered ring now? Don't forget the ketone, as it allowed an impressive rearrangement when samarium iodide was added. A precedent for this reaction was actually already known for 5 years. But how does this craziness work? The ketone is first reduced via single electron transfer with samarium, creating a reactive radical that very quickly reacts with the nearby double bond. Doing so, it creates a funky bridged ring, with the previous four-membered ring breaking down to regenerate the exomethylene and the more stable five-membered ring. This mechanism is pretty sweet, and I hope you feel as great as I do when looking at it. Now, the worst part is over, and it seems like it's just a bunch of non-structural steps. In a major 3-step 1 purification sequence, the team accomplished hydrolysis of the protecting groups, oxidation with DMP to the keto dialdehyde, oxidation of the two aldehydes to the two acids, and esterification. You'll now realize that we're basically done, with just a ketone being required to be reduced to the alcohol. Unfortunately, this was shown to be non-trivial, contrary to what you might expect, because most of the reductions were either unproductive or gave the wrong diastereoselectivity. As in most cases, you just have to try enough random conditions and different types of mechanisms to make things work. So here they found that once again, samarium iodide is the reagent of the hour. Under these radical reduction conditions, the desired epimer was formed in a 2-to-1 ratio, completing the synthesis of gibberellin A18 methyl ester. The selectivity isn't mind-blowing, but hey, it's the last step. And also, you're able to regenerate the starting material by oxidizing the undesired alcohol to the ketone again. I think this was an awesome synthesis, and the intriguing but crucial role of gibberellins gives it much more gravitas than just another total synthesis of a cool-looking but honestly irrelevant molecule. Please like the video and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and as always, until next time.